I'm Captain Albanese. Here is the G2 site. G2 site, the name comes from the fact that it was the second of its type in Italy that was to produce bullets. This site was it's erected in the end of the 1930s. And from 1953 was donated from the family Innocenti to the Italian Army. So when we think about air raid shelters, it dates back to the Second World War. So there was air raid mainly overnights. Here we have a photo, and here we have the enemy. So the enemy. There were those type of shelters, and here I put a photo with military personnel in order to you to understand better than any figures how much damage could cause this type of bombs. Here we have the bombs ready to be loaded in the airplane, and if you see the biggest bomb that was the biggest the man was realized in the mankind. And here we have in the photo the Boeing B-17 Flying Fortress was an American one, and here we have the Lancaster, and here we have the Whitley. I put this type of planes that because that was the first to arrive to Milan. The Whitley, five of them arrives to Milan just 5 days after the Italian declaration of war. So this takes to Milan some of the bombs we have saw before. This is an actual airstrike. It's an actual footage of the 1940, and here the red arrow shows us a probable air attack. And we see the site that we are describing in this presentation. And in the top side, we have the Innocenti factory. And here we can see the same area today. So we can see in the on the left part, the shelters we are going to speak about. And as we can see, it was very close in the close proximity of the switching railway. That was the main switching yard railway in Milan. So now I'm going to present you Ferdinando Innocenti. So I'm going to now to introduce a great story, the story of Innocenti, that is very close and linked to the shelter I'm going to speak in the further slides. So Ferdinando Innocenti made his fortunes because of the Innocenti tubes, as we can see in the photo. And after that, let's say, realization, that becomes spread worldwide because of the fact that this type of tubes become fast to erect a scaffold, and also not only because of the safety, the more safety that we have using that type of tubes that was in steel, but also because that was easy and was fast to assemble a scaffold. At the end of the year 20s, the Innocenti factory started to produce bullets in Rome because of the upcoming Ethiopian war. And at the end of the 40s, the Italian government promoted a plan to produce bullets in large scale, so the production was moved to Milan. Here we can see the photo. The photo of the site, the G2 site, that I'm going to explain in the further slides. And here we can see that in the year 1940, that is the period in time that was the photo I show here, and we can see that the shelter was already erected. Here we have another photo of the year 1936, and on the right side we can see the position that was chosen. The position is was let's say close to the railway yard because of the raw material that came from Bergamo. Bergamo, there was the dalmine. The dalmine gives us the steel to produce bullets, and was also close to the airport, so it was easy to transport the bullets all over Italy and where it was necessary. Here we have the end of the war, so the factory was completely destroyed. Here's a photo, the citizens of Milan can recognize the aqueduct I put on this photo. That's very familiar to the people from Milan. But Ferdinando Innocenti started the reconversion plan and invented the new brand, the Lambretta brand. And here we can see why they choose the name Lambretta, because of the river Lambro that divided the factory of Innocenti in two sides. And here we have the first Lambretta that was produced, the Lambretta 125A. And Innocenti, at the end of the of the year 40, it was the peak of the production of Lambrettas. He produced more or less 100,000 Lambretta in the last year of production. And he sold the Lambretta all over the world, in particular in the southern part of America. So we have Argentina, we have Brazil, we have Ecuador, we have Spain, we have France, we have Germany, we have Taiwan, and now the rights of the brand Lambretta is India. So he sold the brand to India. At the start of the 50s, he invited in Italy the Duke of Edinburgh. That is, we have in the photo, he invited to Milan, because he made an agreement with Lord Nuffield, the one in the photo. Lord Nuffield was the man that was the owner of Morris, that was merged with Austin, to British Motor Company. British Motor Company, they were a factory that produced cars. And here we have the Mini. So Innocenti made the production made in Italy, the production of the Mini in Italy, because of the finishing. So he had the technology to produce and to work with tubes and finishing. And the first car it was produced in Italy, it was the Austin A40S that we have on the bottom in the left side. And here we can see the same structure, architectural structure that I showed you before about the Lambrettas. So you can see that the factory was the same. You can recognize. Here there was the last production that was made in the factory of G2 Side. That was a collaboration with Maserati. That was the Maserati Innocenti. But yeah, we are here to speak about the air right shelter. So now we go into the architectural overview. So Leo Winkel, in 1938, he was the person, was the reference that start with this type of draft put here, and the original patent he received to produce the tower shelter. Here we have the first plan that was presented for the patent. But now we are going to see how Innocenti solution was done. Here's the first draft, the original one, of the Innocenti tower shelter. As we can see, the solution was completely different. Obviously, 2 years was passed, and now we are going to see all the secrets of the tower shelter. The tower shelter, I showed you before, three of them, and each of them are similar, so we are going to study only one of them, okay? So, as we can see, this had a non-perfect cylindrical shape with a conical top, and here we have an aerial plan of the of the site. As we can see, this was a circular, and we have a serviced shaft in the middle. Okay, this was, and then we want to see why it was built and why we have in that way. So this was the entrance. Once we enter, we don't see any door, and it seems to be the question why, but it's very easy, because if a bomb hit the entrance of the shelter, we can see that the gases can go forward this corridor and can exit on the other side, as shown with red arrow in the photo. So for this reason, that was a clever idea, because of this solution, we could have a very, very thick door, a door of just a couple of centimeters of steel. That was very clever idea, because it was cheap, it was, functional. And the door, for this reason, the function of the door was because of the chemical attack. So if we think about the chemical attack, the gases, the toxic agent, goes down because of the gravity. So this door was, put in that place just to avoid the gases enter in the shelter and create problems to the people that were over there. So now we enter into the bunker. The first thing we will see in front of us is an helicoidal ramp. So now we're gonna see why the solution was a ramp that was an helical shape. Because with an helical shape, we have the possibility to have a quick entry and fast exit. So the bunker could be loaded very fast, and the people could have the shelter inside without any obstacles. So the shelter could be filled in a very fast time. The second point is that an helical shape favorites the air ventilation inside the bunker. And so in comparison with the bunker that has stairs that we have in the right side, we can see that we have some problems with the circulation of the air. So we have only one cell. The first point is about the helicoidal shape. We can compare it with a column. If we have a column, as we can see in the photo here, on that shape, helicoidal shape creates an made the structure more stronger to the possible hit of a bomb, direct hit of a bomb in the bunker. Now we're gonna have a close look going up into the ramp. We can find also the seatings. Why? Because once you get inside the bunker, you don't know how many time you would be over there. So, and also for the people that were over there, they could have some rest. And also it creates a better solution to have more people to be recovered inside. Because if the people are seated, you have more space available for other person to come inside the shelter. And here we have written inside, keep calm, you are safe. And here you can find the right position where I took this photo, so just to have a sort of navigator inside the bunker. At the top, we find the sliding doors in steel. Why we have this? Because if we go farther, exactly at the top, we can find some stores where there could be stored mask for a chemical attack, blankets, covers, maybe first aid task. We don't know exactly what that was recovered, but for sure those sliding doors helped the people not to find out and not to make them go farther. And then we see at the end the reason. And now we're going to speak about surviving plans. So if we think about bunker, we have to think about that the people that were inside recovered, they need air ventilation system. So the air that was outside the bunker could be, let's say, toxic. So here we have the point that the air was drawn inside the bunker. Then the air goes through this tube, and here we have a valve just to close in case of chemical attack was, let's say, a little bit strong. Then the air goes down. Here we can find the shaft, I said before. So inside the bunker, that was the helicoid ramp, and here we have the place that there was put the service facilities. In this case, we have the tube for the air ventilation and the stair for maintenance. And here we have the right position where it was this type of shaft. If we go further, we found out the air ventilation system. And here we found the filters, the carbon filters. The motor of the carbon filter was activated using the bicycle. There was two bicycles in line so that the people that were recovered inside the bunker can use that bicycle. We don't found the seats, we don't found the handlebars, but we can see the shape of the chain of the bicycle. See, we have 1, 2, 3, and 4 person that can use this in order to create a ventilation system inside the bunker. And also, and here we have the air that was already, let's say, purified and then was distributed inside the shelter. And here we have a door for the service shaft where the air can be distributed inside the bunker and where people can go up and down the bunker in order to maintain the bunker and to move in case of a bomb hit directly the bunker from the external side. Here we have another, way to explain the air ventilation system. So we can see that from the bottom side up to above, it was put off the exhaust air. So there was a continuous change of air inside the bunker because of the helical shape of the ramp we found inside the bunker. And also there was also some basic facilities. Here we have a bathroom that was in the opposite side of the service shaft. In that side, here we have, as we saw before, the tubes for the air ventilation and the stairs, and on the other side we have also basic facilities. There was the possibility to use the water that we cannot rule out that was put on the upper side, on the conical side of the bunker. So the people that was recovered can use the water in order to wash the face in case of chemical attack, and also to use the bathroom. So here we have an probable water tank above. Here we have the emergency exit. The emergency exit was 80 per 80 centimeters large, and using a rope ladder, we can exit and be outside in case of the entrance was full of debris or was not usable for a lot of reasons. And that is most important things we have to point it out about this bunker was the fact that this was also prevent a bunker buster. What is a bunker buster? from the photo I put, this is a technology that was invented at the end of the World War. So that means that who projected this type of shelter prevent also this type of problem. So what is a bunker buster? This is a bomb that when it found empty space explodes. So if we apply this in that bunker, we have a sort of bomb that enter when found empty space explodes, and the gases and debris goes down. And this ceiling was here to mitigate the effect of the bunker buster bomb that hit directly the bunker. And maybe the sliding doors that is connected to what I said before was to protect the people not to have access on that side of the bunker. well, so we can see that this particular bunker saves a lot of lives and stood the test of the time we have already over there. That means that was effective because of the fact that we have evidence that this site was bombed more than 10 times. If we look to the bibliography I put here on the slide, especially the second one, if you have a close look, we will find that the factory was bombed the first time in the 18th of August at 4 in the night. Ringrazio tutti quanti voi per aver avuto questa possibilità.